time J and then I'm doing the tennis serve. The tennis serve is a rotational and sequential motion employing the entirety of the individual's body to begin a tennis match. Fast twitch A fibers are utilized to conduct this motion because the muscles make use of the anaerobic metabolism to produce the quick motion with great force, but it also uses aerobic metabolism to allow the individual to carry out this motion for a lengthy time. Additionally, the kinetic chain, sequential action of muscles, angular momentum, Newton's laws of linear motion, and impact forces are used. These will be discussed throughout the presentation. First is the setup position. The feet are perpendicular to the net, with the left foot nearer the baseline and the right foot diagonally distal from the left foot. This aids in the rotation of the medial transverse plane for the follow through, which is the defining point of the entire motion. As the motion begins, the quadriceps of the left leg pretense to carry the weight difference, while the body or trunk of the individual leans into the frontal anterior plane. This activates the rectus abdominis to stabilize the trunk in the leaning position. The left anterior pronator quadratus muscle contracts and relaxes to bounce the tennis ball, acting as a third class lever. When the right arm bearing the tennis racket is accelerated via the right deltoid muscle to the frontal anterior plane, the individual begins to pretense the right quadricep as the weight begins to become evenly distributed between both legs. As this happens, the trunk begins to extend into the frontal plane, still activating the rectus abdominis. This is preparing for the follow through. As the trunk is extending into the frontal plane, the left arm begins to extend and accelerate upwards proximal to the trunk, thus initiating the left deltoid muscle. It is preparing to release the ball at full extension. In conjunction, the right arm decelerates from the right scapular ball and socket joint to a position that is distal from the trunk. This leads into the second key point of the full toss. At this point, the left arm is fully extended at 90 degrees with a vertical flexion of the left hand. You cannot see it here, but this flexion has released the ball at a projection height of about 1 meter above the height of myself standing tall with a racket in a vertical position above my head. Would be 1 meter above that height. However, the ball is released just off to the left of my left shoulder. This allows for a medial transverse rotation, which creates speed and spin on the ball. If the ball was released straight above my head, this could not happen. As the ball reaches the maximum projection height, there will be a point of no acceleration or deceleration. This is the desired time to hit the tennis ball via the follow through. The 90 degree angle of the left arm releases the tennis ball at the same projection angle. This angle will remain the same until an external force, in this case the tennis racket head, hits the ball and directs it downwards. But for the racket head to act upon the tennis ball, it must go through a series of angular movements, each creating potential energy and finally exerting kinetic energy during the follow through. The angle created via the deceleration of the right arm is at 45 degrees. This is a measure from the right scapula, right hip, and right fist. This angle will assist in the next angular transference of the right arm leading up to the follow through. Without this step-by-step angular movement, the trunk will be restricted to rotate and the tennis ball would be hit very flat, so without any spin. This step of the movement has completed the first part of the kinetic chain of upper arm flexion. The kinetic chain is a chain where all body segments in some shape or form are linked together. The movement of any of the body segments is a result of the previous movement. Therefore, if one movement is broken or incomplete, the rest of the movement will be carried out incorrectly. After the ball toss, the distal right arm begins to accelerate upwards, almost to full extension at 90 degrees, but then retreats to an acute angle of about 80 degrees. The arm retreats to this angle because a greater force can be generated by storing potential energy during contraction of a muscle than throwing or hitting a tennis ball from a fully extended position. The movement of this right arm utilizes the rotation of the right scapular ball and socket joint and deltoid muscles required to lift the arm. While this movement occurs, the left quadriceps and hamstrings tense while the knees bend at the pivotal hinge joint as weight is transferred from the right leg to the left leg. Resultingly, the right leg abandons on the left leg and moves to a perpendicular position beside the left leg, also bending out the right pivotal hinge joint. Similarly, the right quadriceps and hamstring tense, conducting a neutral weight distribution. The right leg moves into this position because it's closer to the point of application of the hips to allow for a full rotation of the medial transverse plane. Trunk remains in the frontal plane, still activating the rectus abdominis, while the left arm still remains fully extended. This leads into the third key point of the knee bend. In this position, the bent legs are storing potential energy with the quadriceps, hamstrings, and the gastrocnemius. This will be converted to kinetic energy as the potential energy produces enough force to overcome the inertia of the entire body as the movement continues through to the follow through. The legs bend at an angle of about 94 degrees. This angle will assist in the transference of angular momentum through the trunk of the body in the medial transverse plane rotation. The right arm is cocked back, also storing potential energy within the biceps and triceps that will create a force transfer through the racket head and into the tennis ball. This completes the second part of the kinetic chain, the upper arm elevation. The previous movement allowed the individual to accelerate the arm upwards because the trunk was stabilized by the rectus abdominis and the left arm was fully extended. The final stage of the movement is the follow through. At this point, the individual begins to extend both legs as the gastrocnemius, with the assistance of the Achilles tendon, contract and relax to conduct a process known as plantar flexion. It elevates the heel of both legs. This is beginning to release the potential energy stored within the muscles. As the individual begins to convert this potential energy into kinetic energy, Newton's third law of linear motion appears. The amount of force resulting from the application of the knee bend will be equally exerted from the asphalt surface, assisting in the creation of kinetic energy. This is known as reaction forces. In conjunction, the extended right arm begins to release the potential energy within the biceps and triceps by decelerating and entering the frontal posterior plane at a right angle, shown by the yellow dots in the video clip. The right arm rotation, again utilizing the right scapula, ball and socket joint in conjunction with the right deltoid muscle. The yellow dots appear further and further apart as the racket head is gaining velocity. The racket head is gaining velocity once the right arm begins to accelerate upwards as the trunk begins to rotate into the frontal anterior plane facing the receiver. The trunk rotates into this position via the angular momentum generated by the sequential right arm movements throughout the entire motion. The right arm generated enough force aside the leg drive to overcome this inertia of the entire body. This movement activates the rectus abdominis, external obliques, and latissimus dorsi for the trunk rotation, and the right rhomboids, bicep, triceps, and trapezius to lift the arm. Similarly, the ball and socket joint is utilized for the rotation of the arm. The right arm, once again, does not fully extend as this does not provide sufficient amount of force to hit the tennis ball. Lastly, the left arm has decelerated downwards to a position proximal to the trunk and moved this position to allow for the trunk to complete its rotation. However, usually my arm is like close to, like really bending close to my body, which isn't the best because it does still restrict you, and the best is to have it on the side of the arm. I can never do that for this. Yeah. This completes the leg drive and the trunk rotation component of the follow through. It was possible due to the correct completion of the knee bend that position the right arm at an angle that could retract and rotate the trunk as the legs storing the potential energy to drive the trunk upwards. Finally, we have the last component of the motion and kinetic chain, the forearm extension, upper arm internal rotation, and forearm pronation. During this smaller motion, a considerable amount of the trunk has rotated on its axis to a point where it can rotate no more. This is a stage where the right arm completes its rotation of the right scapula, ball and socket joint. As mentioned earlier, the right rhomboids, bicep, triceps and trapezius control this action. To hit the tennis ball, the wrist must undergo pronation, which is the movement of rotating the wrist downwards on the top of the tennis ball. This activates the pronator quadratus muscle. As this happens, the arm decelerates and lands, pre-tensing the hamstrings, quadriceps and gastrocnemius, while the weight and finishes at a position proximal to the left-hand side of the individual. The individual themselves continues to move forward as the weight and force is still moving forward. When the racket head finally comes in contact with the tennis ball, various things happen. First is the impact forces caused by the angle at which the tennis racket hits the tennis ball. The individual hits the ball at a 2 o'clock position, applying a weak topspin. This topspin spin will affect how the ball rebounds on the other side of the net and influence the stroke the player, stroke the receiving hits. Secondly, Newton's law of linear motion appears. As mentioned in the ball toss key point, the projection angle of the ball will remain the same until the racket, acting as external force, contacts the ball and drags it downwards. The individual in this clip is pronating her wrist entirely around the ball, therefore the ball will be directed to the forehand side of the receiver. Lastly, as the individual hits the tennis ball, the racket provides the ball with a momentum that is proportional to the force generated by the angular movement throughout the movement. At this stage of the individual, the force wouldn't be as great compared to professional tennis players who hit the ball with such a great force. This is known as Newton's third law of linear motion. The most well-known injury that can occur from the tennis serve is tennis elbow. It occurs when the outside tendons of the elbow degenerate from repetitive use, creating small tears. This degenerative process generally occurs during the stage where the wrist cocks back and the tennis racket cocks back the tennis racket, possibly overextending the extensor carpe radius brevis. Tennis elbow can cause significant pain whenever the individual grasps an object or cocks back their wrist. However, the pain does not have a quick onset, rather a slow and sequential with the constant use of the arm in the movements mentioned above. There are various ways of treating and dealing with the pain caused by a tennis elbow. However, it will never be completely treated as the tears are located within the tendons. The most common treatments include changing the way the individual carries out the motion and the tennis racket itself. This is usually done in partnership with a tennis coach who would advise the individual to hit the ball in the centre of the racket. Also, the string tension on the racket itself may be too tight and cause a lot of strain on the wrist as the individual hits the tennis ball. And an elbow brace is also the most common implement used to treat tennis elbow. As the name suggests, it's a brace worn over the elbow during tennis or other activities that need the cocking and grasping function of the wrist. The elbow brace is designed to redirect the pull of the muscles utilizing the action, therefore providing pain relief, possibly not fixing the problem. However, in my experience, many people use the elbow brace during the matches and fix their swing pattern with their coaches, hopefully abandoning the use of the elbow brace in the future. The tennis serve is a movement that cannot be correctly carried out every single time, and as fatigue sets in, the motion becomes more careless. Here is an example of this shown in this comparative video setup, where the knee bend is completely dissimilar to each other. The left clip shows the individual placing the right foot in the desired position, but also stepping forward with the left foot. This does not have much effect on the overall performance of the movement. Clearly shown here, the individual steps over the baseline before hitting the ball, resulting in a foot fault. A foot fault may be crucial to the mental psychology of the individual in the sense that they may begin to lose their confidence, disrupting their entire game. Whereas the right clip depicts the individual bringing the right foot in front of the left foot and further away from the desired position shown in the left clip. This affects the overall performance of the serve. The trunk still remains in the frontal plane, but as the follow-through is conducted, the trunk cannot fully rotate and transfer angular momentum into the tennis ball because of the distance between the two legs. More weight is placed on the right leg, therefore more effort is required to provide a driving motion, but also the sequential action of muscles want to rotate the legs before the trunk to carry out the angular motion. This results in the lack of trunk rotation and hitting the tennis ball late. These different positions are the result of the placement of the ball toss. The right one shows a ball toss that is projected to the left of the left shoulder compared to the right clip that depicts a ball toss projected to the centre or right of the trunk. To fix this, it's just practice makes perfect where you